happy to take your question in French or in English.
Minister, Canada refused to sign the TPP in Vietnam. So what's changed in the last few months, and what did Canada gain in the last couple of months?
Well, you know, when we were in Da Nang in Vietnam with the Prime Minister, what you saw is that we stood up for Canada. We were on the international scene, and we said for Canada, for this agreement to work for Canada, we need to address specific issues. And you saw that we were forceful in our position. And since then, we've been working to reach an agreement with our partners, notably on the cultural sector, making sure that we'll have bilateral side letters with every nation to respect our ability to protect, defend, and promote our culture across Canada, because this is essential for Canadians. We also stood up for the auto sector, making sure that we would have a side letter with Japan that would provide the greatest market access ever for the auto industry, the first ever enforceable side letter for the auto sector, making sure that they would have market access, not only for today, but also Japan committing that should they give any better treatment to the United States or Europe, that Canada will benefit from these opening up of their market. So I think that it was worthwhile to make sure that we stood up for Canadians when we're in Vietnam. And all along, we've been working to continue to improve the terms of the deals for Canadians.
And you didn't say that the TPP will hurt workers, right?
On the eve of the NAFTA talks, why wouldn't it have made more sense from a leverage point of view to have waited to see how they unfolded?
Well, I would say we were at a point of maximum leverage. You know, when we were in Da Nang, we raised these issues. As you know, Canada was pretty forceful. You might remember what people reported back from Da Nang, that Canada stood up very strongly while Southern nations were probably prepared to go along. We wanted to make sure that we said all along, in any trade deals we're doing, we just don't want any deal. We want a good deal for Canada. And I said at the time, it was not about next Monday, it's about the next few decades. So we need to make sure that we have the right basis. Our negotiators were in Tokyo, as you know, this week, with the special envoy, Jan Mikke, of the Prime Minister. And this was the time to conclude and use that moment to improve the terms of the deal. And as you know, every trade agreement has its own dynamic. This was the time of maximum leverage for Canada, and we use it to make sure that we could secure a good deal for Canadians.
Are you sending a message to the U.S. that Canada can do it without you?
Well, the message we're sending, I would say, is the same message we've been sending all along, that diversification is key for Canada. As you know, we represent about, 0.5% of the world population and 2.5% of global trade. I often joke that trade is in the DNA of Canadians. You know, for us, opening up market is essential. We did that last year when the CETA agreement, the trade agreement with Europe, opened up a market of 500 million consumers in Europe. And we said that we will continue in our trade diversification. Obviously, once we have achieved that, it was time to look east. And certainly markets like Japan, Vietnam, Malaysia are big markets for Canada. Japan is the third largest economy of the world. So to make sure that Canada is well positioned, not only now, but for the future, was essential. So therefore, I think that people will understand around the world. I keep saying today, it's not really the size of your population which matter, but it's the size of your market access. As firms are born global more and more today, what really matters is making sure that they would have market access. And I think this is a great achievement for Canadians and Canadian workers.
So how will average workers see a benefit for this?
Well, very tangibly, let me take steel, for example. So steel workers, steel today is subject to tariff, if I look at Vietnam, of double digits, something around 40%. Well, the steel tariff will go down to zero over 10 years. If you take aluminum, you know, those tariffs, depending where you export in the countries of the CPTPP, if I take the case of Vietnam again, I think it's double digit, around 30%. These tariffs will go down to zero over 3 years. If I look at life sciences, which Canada export to the tune of billions to these markets, the tariffs will be eliminated when this agreement comes into force. So these are very tangible examples that in different sector of economy, I can take forestry, where obviously, you know, we have been looking at a market like Vietnam to export our forest products. So for me, how workers benefit is by making sure that we open up these markets, because, you know, tariff is a barrier for exports. And if I look at the auto sector, in my view, by reducing, by removing the non-tariff trade barriers, which were around safety standards, we have provided the auto sector for the first time, I would say, meaningful market access by removing these trade barriers that were present. That's the first time that the auto sector in North America and Canada, for sure, sees an enforceable side letter with Japan that would allow them to do more with this particular country.
Could you walk us through the last couple of days and what led to the breakthrough in Tokyo with Japan on the auto parts? En français aussi.
Well, the last few days, I mean, we have been continuing to engage, you know, since Da Nang. You would expect that with the Prime Minister, with the Special Envoy, with Minister Joly, myself, Minister Baines, obviously, chiefly being engaged in making sure that we consult with industry, because the outcome we have achieved today, I think every Canadian should feel proud, because this is something we did together. This was Team Canada. This is something that we crafted together. We listened to industry to see what would make more sense, understanding that some may disagree on some aspect of it. But I reached out and say, albeit you might disagree, help us improve it the way you would like to see it. And that's why we work specifically on culture in the auto sector, to make sure that we would craft something which is meaningful for Canadians. So I would say, thanks to the effort, obviously, of the Prime Minister, at the highest level, and the work that the negotiating team and, like I said, cabinet has been doing, we landed in a good place for Canadians. This is an opportunity, like I said, to join in the largest trading agreement of the world, 500 million people, 14% of the global economy. This is something that, when you look at trade over decades, is a good deal, is an improved deal for Canada. As you know, this is a deal that was negotiated under previous government. So my role as trade minister was to make sure that we sat down, we took the time needed to improve, to enhance this deal for Canadians, and that's why we stood up for them in Vietnam. That's why we continue this week to improve, and that's what we'll do in any trade deal.
More questions?
Representatives from the auto industry were critical of the original proposed rules of origin. Have those improved or changed at all with this revised agreement?
So what we've been, and I've been engaging with them, like I said, understanding that people had concerns. And as you know, this deal was negotiated over a long period of time. When I came as minister, my role was to make sure that we lasered on what would make a real difference for the industry. What we've achieved is really in terms of market access. Part of the issues that our industry were facing is the inability to effectively export into markets like Japan because of the non-tariff trade barriers. So our focus was really to make sure that we would agree in a bilateral side letter with Japan to remove these non-tariff trade barriers, and not only for today, but to the most favored nation clause, that whatever concession Japan would give to the United States or Europe, or for any other country for that matter, Canada would benefit from them. So this is the first time that we have an enforceable side letter for the auto sector. I think it's a significant achievement. And if you look at trade over decades, this could be certainly with first mover advantage, giving a preferential advantage to the Canadian auto sector.
Last question.
Canada was blamed for sabotaging this agreement at the APEC summit in November. There are harsh words that came down. What do you say to the detractors now?
Well, I'd say, listen, if standing up for Canada and Canadian workers, people want to refer to that, as you said, I'll take it as a compliment. I mean, for us, we said it was, the Prime Minister was clear, it was never about next Friday, it's about the next few decades. I think it was right for Canada to stand up. I think it was right to stand up for Canadian workers, for the auto sector, for the cultural sector in Canada. By standing up for Canada, we said to our allies and friends that for us, although we wanted to be part of the largest trading agreement in the world, it had to make sense for Canadians. This is a deal that was negotiated by the previous government, and when we came here, we wanted to make sure that we improved it and that we listened to stakeholders. We did that we received tens of thousands of submissions of Canadians on that, and this is our way of doing, open and transparent. People were engaged with us, and I take pride in the fact that we stood up for Canadians, and at the end of the day, we got a better deal for that. in my view, that's the way to go.
Does it send a message to NAFTA negotiators? I mean, you said the timing of this announcement is excellent. And is that because we're, you know, about to go into another round of NAFTA negotiations? Are you sending a message to those, you know, to the U.S. In NAFTA negotiations?
Well, I'd say, I guess I'm sending a message to Canadians first and foremost that, you know, we said from the beginning with the Prime Minister that trade diversification was key. You know, the United States is our largest trading partner and will always be there. Geography, the size of the economy. Our relationship is providing millions of good middle-class jobs. But when you have more than 70% of your export to one country, I think people would realize that it's in Canada's best interest to look west and to look east. That's what we did when we opened up the trade agreement with Europe. And now we were looking east with positioning Canada for success, not only now, but for the decades to come. And clearly, when you're looking at fast-growing economy like Vietnam, like Malaysia, Japan, the third largest economy of the world, I think it makes sense for Canada as a Pacific nation to position itself for success for the decades to come.
Thank you.
Merci.